Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I predict we are in for quite an evening. This is lecture 6 in our 7-part lecture series, Deep Time, Global Change, and You. And if you remember, if you were here last week, and I said that I was quite excited because it was the first time I'd been on stage introducing someone who had their own wiki page. That was John Clegg, and I said he wasn't the first. It wasn't the only one. Well, Beth Shapiro also has her own wiki page, and I'm equally excited to be sharing the stage with her this evening. Now, Beth comes from a small town called Rome, Georgia. She went to the University of Georgia. She got a Rhodes Scholarship. She went to Oxford, and it turns out, and I had forgotten, we actually had the same PhD supervisor. She stayed there on a junior research fellowship and then went to Penn State. And then from Penn State, in 2010, she went to the University of California in Santa Cruz, and that's where she's come from today. I don't list everyone's accolades and all the prizes that they get because usually the list is too long, so I'm sure if you've read the little blurb, you will know that among many of the other things that many of the other awards that Beth has received, she also received a MacArthur Fellowship, which we refer to as the Genius Award. And she got that in 2009. Now, she started working on ancient DNA in grad school. Her first degree actually was in geology and ecology, which makes it very fitting that she's in this series. And her talk has both extremely exciting technology and extremely exciting philosophy, because what she's going to talk about is de-extinction. What if extinction is not forever? A molecular paleontologist's view of de-extinction. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Beth Shapiro.
Oh, how about now? Okay. First, I would like to say thank you. I did not make my own Wikipedia page. I don't know how it arrived, but it did. One day it was there. It's kind of embarrassing, but whatever. Anyway, I would like to thank Arna for that introduction and Rolf Matthews for twisting my arm to come here, Karen for being my host, and all of you for coming out on this nice, wet, rainy, cold evening to hear what I'm pretty confident is going to be the most insane talk of this particular series of lectures. De-extinction. This is a word, an idea, that has gotten a considerable amount of attention from the popular press over the last couple of months. Some might even say more than it deserves. And I have to say, I have been involved with discussions with many, many journalists or a person trying to do research to put together a documentary about de-extinction. And the one thing that I've learned in doing all of this is that nobody, and that includes the scientists who are supposedly working in this field, really has any idea or agreement about what this word actually means, de-extinction, de-extinction. And yet, despite this, pretty much everybody has a strong feeling about it, strong feelings in favor of de-extinction or strong opposition to the idea of de-extinction, despite not really knowing what it means. And so tonight, my goal is to deliver in 3 parts an outline of what I think de-extinction is, to try to provide you with the knowledge that you can then use to make up your own mind about whether de-extinction is a good idea, whether it's something we should be investing brain power or actual financial resources into, and whether or not you're going to believe it when you read a headline that says something has been de-extinct-ed. Can we make up this word? Can we use it as a verb and a noun and a gerund and all these different things? Probably not. So anyway, in 3 parts, I'm going to go through this. The first part, could we? What is the actual science? What can we do right now? What still needs to be developed? The next part, would we? So where are we in actually doing this? Are there different groups that are involved with de-extinction research, and how far along are they? And then finally, should we? And this really comes to the part where we start to talk about the ethics of de-extinction, and this is my opinion that I'm going to project to you, and that hopefully we can then use all of this as a starting point for a pretty good discussion about de-extinction in the second hour of this. So I'm a teacher. I teach introductory biology. At Penn State, I taught introductory biology to 720 smiling 18-year-olds. And by this point in the lecture, most of them were asleep. So I thought that I should start by giving you a quiz. And if you get it wrong, you have to leave. So, I'm just kidding. So, what do Richard Attenborough and B.D. Wong have to do with de-extinction? Both of them? Oh, yes, yes. It's true. These are the two gentlemen that brought us the very first successful de-extinction. And of course, this went off without a hitch. It was perfect. No unpredicted consequences, nothing bad going on, no disasters to have to clean up. This is exactly the kind of science fiction that we want to turn into reality. Exactly the thing that we want to happen in our lives tomorrow, right? Okay, so just to get to know you guys a little bit first. How many of you think de-extinction is a good idea? How many of you think it's a terrible idea? How many of you are still undecided? That's good. We've got a bunch of undecided. How many of you think de-extinction is possible today? We've got one. That's good. In a year? 5 years? 20 years? Never? We got a taker on never back there, too. Okay, so of course I know the answer because I'm a scientist, right? Actually, I don't know the answer because I'm a scientist, and that is the reason that probably you should trust me. Okay, so you probably really are sitting there saying, so who are you to be standing in front of us here claiming to know something about de-extinction? Show me, prove to me that you are the kind of person that I should listen to. So in fairness, let me tell you a little bit about my research and how I got involved in this discipline or sub-discipline of science that I affectionately call crazy. So I'm the kind of scientist who spends most of my time in the lab, moving small amounts of liquid from one tube to another, or sitting behind a computer, typing, answering emails, writing grant proposals. But during the summer, I prefer to spend my days and nights in the far north. While I'm there, I split my time pretty evenly between waging war against mosquitoes and searching for the remains of Ice Age plants and animals. Why the Arctic? Well, apart from its just pure beauty, the Arctic is cold and has been cold for a very long time. In fact, for about the last million years or so, the Earth has oscillated between very cold glacial intervals and much warmer interglacial periods. And during these glacial intervals, the sea level was a lot lower than it is today because much of the oceans were taken up into forming glaciers across the continents here. This part of the world here that is a lighter color is shallower water, and that means that during these glacial periods, when the sea level was lower, there was land here. In fact, this was a land bridge, very important land bridge, that was a conduit for gene flow and the movement of organisms, both plants and animals, including our own species. This part of the world here, called Beringia, is where I do most of my work. And this is because Beringia, during these periods, was wet. It was wet enough to actually have a pretty rich grassland that supported lots of animals, but not so wet that it itself was glaciated. So it supported, it was a glacial refuge for these diversity of plants and animals that have become associated with the ice ages, mammoths and woolly rhinos in Asia and North American camels and lions and all sorts of things that are extinct today. And while these species are no longer with us, their bones and teeth and hair and tusks and sometimes, if we're lucky, complete frozen, preserved, mummified remains are found frozen in the dirt we call permafrost because it's always frozen. So we look for bones wherever the permafrost is melting, around rivers, around lakes, along rivers after the spring melt, and at active gold mining sites such as this one near Dawson City in the Yukon, as the gold miners are using these high-pressure water hoses to clear off the melted permafrost. Thousands and thousands of bones are exposed, and we go along and pick them up and take them back to the lab, grind up a little piece of them, and extract their DNA. And over the last 15 years or so, myself and colleagues from around the world have extracted DNA from tens of thousands of remains from a variety of different organisms. And we use these remains to address questions like, how does climate change, and specifically the type of rapid climate change that we see both into and out of the ice ages, affect the genetic diversity and population size and distribution and abundance of different animals? We focused quite a lot on bison and horses in North America. We can trace the movements of species like mammoths and brown bears across the Northern Hemisphere. We've recently shown that brown bears around 30,000 years ago dispersed pretty quickly out of Alaska, across all of Northern Siberia and into Europe, presumably in response to growing numbers of bison and horses that they were using as a food source. And we ask questions like, why do some species, like the cave lion, go extinct while other species, like the caribou, continue to survive and even thrive in the present day? And no matter how excited we are about our results, no matter how awesome and cool and exciting and novel and interesting and world-changing and spectacular and wonderful these things are, whenever we get a call from someone from the popular press about any of our research, we are asked one thing. Does this mean we can clone a mammoth? So, you won't be surprised that several months ago, when this spectacular creature was found, preserved, frozen in the Siberian permafrost, and everybody was positive that this, because the last one hadn't worked and the one before that hadn't worked, this one was going to be the mammoth that we were going to clone to bring back a mammoth, that we were all completely inundated with phone calls and requests from the popular press about whether we were going to be able to clone a mammoth now that we have such a spectacular find. So the answer is no. And to really explain why, I think I need to tell you, in case you already don't know, what we mean by cloning. And cloning is a specific scientific process. And it is the specifics of the cloning process that explain why this is not how animals are going to become de-extinct. So when people think of cloning, what generally comes to mind is this process called somatic cell nuclear transfer. This was the process that, in about 1996, in Roslin Institute in Scotland, brought us Dolly the sheep, the very first famous cloned mammal. The way that they made Dolly was they took a somatic cell. Now, every body is made up of two types of cells, somatic cells, which are found in our skin and teeth and hairs and pretty much everywhere, and germline cells, gametes. These are eggs and sperm, and that's it. Somatic cells here, this is what is going to be transferred. So they took a mammary cell, a somatic cell, from a Finn Dorset sheep, and they put it in a Petri dish, and they starved those cells. They stressed them out. They starved them and made them kind of really uncomfortable in their life as a cell. And at the same time, they took egg cells from a different type of sheep, and they removed the nucleus from that egg cell, producing what's called an enucleated cell. Then they took these starved, stressed out cells, and they put them next to these enucleated eggs, zapped them with a bit of electricity, the membranes of those cells popped open, and the nucleus from this stressed out cell went into this enucleated egg cell. They zap it again with electricity, and magic, this somatic cell starts behaving as if it's a fertilized egg. And it grows up into an embryo that's put inside a different type of sheep. And months later, we have a sheep born that looks nothing like the mom, nothing like the donor of the egg, but quite a lot like the donor of the initial somatic cell. And this is how somatic cell nuclear transfer works. So why does it work? It took about 10 years for a paper to be published by this guy here, Shinya Yamanaka, who last year, 2012 actually, shared the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine with Sir John Gurdon for discovering that cells, somatic cells, can actually be can actually be tricked into forgetting what type of cell they are. So that mammary cell was pretty sure that it was going to be a mammary cell. It was completely differentiated. But it turns out that you can de-differentiate a cell. You can make it forget what it is and go back to a kind of primordial state where it can then become any other type of cell. That's called an induced pluripotent stem cell. That cell then has the power to become a hair cell, or a tissue cell, or a liver cell, or a heart cell, any other type of cell. And Yamanaka discovered that you could do this in a petri dish by adding a bunch of different chemicals that cause that differentiated cell that already knew what it was to forget its job and reset to become a pluripotent stem cell. So with all of this fancy pants technology ready to go, it's pretty clear how scientists, and there are two different groups of scientists that are right now working to do this with mammoths. These are the folks that go out to find these fantastic remains, are going to clone a mammoth. They're going to find an intact somatic cell. They're going to use this magic and induce that cell to pluripotency. They're going to cause it to de-differentiate. They're going to stick it inside an elephant cell and cause it to start developing into a mammoth from its de-differentiated state. Stick that inside an elephant. 2 years later, they're going to have a baby elephant. Mammoth. Mammoth. Right. But there's a problem with that. And that's that all of these things, somatic cell nuclear transfer, embryonic stem cells, and induced pluripotent stem cells have something in common, and that is this C here. This is a cell. It turns out that in these remains, in bones and teeth and hair and skin and even mummies, there are no intact cells. None. There are no intact cells and no intact nuclei. There are no intact nuclei that contain intact genomes that can be used in somatic cell nuclear transfer. When an organism dies, the DNA inside the cells begins to decay immediately. There are enzymes that live inside our own bodies whose job it is to break down DNA and cellular structures. We have these enzymes in the tips of our fingers so that when we touch things that contain pathogens, we start to break them down before they can infect us and make us sick. And when we die, these same enzymes from our own bodies start to break down our DNA. In addition to that, an organism that is dead will all of a sudden have a whole bunch of circulating and colonizing microorganisms and fungi and plants. And all of these different organisms are going to have these nucleases, these enzymes that break down the cellular structure and the cell walls. This is a long-winded way of saying there are no cells. And where there are no cells, there will be no clones. The end. Okay, so that was a very long way to get into the actual possible science of de-extinction. And I did say that there are teams that are out there who still think that this is going to be possible. It is my strong feeling, based on science and spending a lot of my life working on ancient DNA, that that is not going to work. But there are other ways, and this is where my own work comes in. So what's plan B for could we bring an extinct species back to life? Plan B, easy. Use genomics. Use modern DNA sequencing technology. We know that we can go out there into the field and collect remains that contain DNA, not long strands, not intact cells, but broken up pieces of DNA that we can piece together and actually make the genomes of these extinct things. So all we have to do is that. So here are what I'm calling the at least seven steps to de-extinct a species. There I went using it as a verb. Using genomics. All right. So step one, sequence the genome. Easy. Step two, turn that genome into chromosomes. We actually don't know how to do that. Step three, insert those chromosomes into a nucleus of a cell. We don't know how to do that. Step four, insert that nucleus into the cell. We can totally do that. That is somatic cell nuclear transfer. See, we're already one part of the way there for this particular process here. Step five, find a surrogate that's going to be able to carry this thing to term, have it actually be born. And actually, with a mammoth, this part is not that straightforward either, because a mammoth is actually quite a lot larger than an elephant. So there are some hypotheses out there that this kind of carrying a mammoth baby to term thing might not go very well for the female elephant who's involved. We can get there, though. Maybe we need mini mammoths first. And then, of course, we find a place for the mammoths to live. So all of this kind of all together is really, really quite straightforward. Maybe. So in 2008, there was the first publication of genome data from a mammoth. The people who published this mammoth genome data managed to sequence about 3 billion bases of mammoth DNA, and that's a lot. That's a lot of mammoth DNA to be sequenced. Piecing it all together and trying to make it into a genome, what we learned was that they had recovered approximately half of the mammoth genome sequence in doing this work. So instead of this, what we've actually got is something that looks more like this. But that's okay. In 2008, that was state-of-the-art, and today it's still pretty much state-of-the-art for most ancient genomes. There's a lot of data in here. In fact, does anyone know how many mammalian species have genomes that have been sequenced entirely to completion? How many mammals? Should be pretty easy, right? How about somebody shout out a guess? One. Who, us? Yeah, no. None, not even us. And there is an honest-to-goodness shitload of human DNA sequence out there, and we haven't quite managed to sequence our own genome to completion. I'm being a little bit unfair. We know most of the sequence of what's called the euchromatin. That's the part of the genome where the genes live. What we don't know the entire sequence of is the heterochromatin. This is part of the genome that is tightly packed, condensed repeat regions. They mostly around the centromeres, the center of the chromosomes, and the telomeres, the ends of the chromosomes. Because this is repeat regions, it's just really hard to sequence through it. And in all honesty, we don't really know if it's important to know those bits of the genome, but we don't know, because we haven't been able to sequence through it. So we're close with the human genome, but you know, we're still doing pretty well. But anyway, we've got this, and we want to make this. So how do we get from 50% of the mammoth genome to a mammoth? Again, pretty straightforward. We just sequence more of it, right? Finish the genome. We go out into Siberia, we look for really well-preserved remains, we find some, we take a chunk out of the lab, we bring it back to the lab, and we sequence the crap out of it until we have the whole thing, right? Easy. Okay, so there are two problems with that. First, if I were to sequence DNA from a bit of my own hair or cheek swab or something like this, and I extracted the DNA and I got a big pool of everything that was in that DNA extract, and then I sequenced it, I sequenced all of it using an approach that's known as shotgun sequencing, what the results would look like is that about 99% of it or more would map to the human reference genome, because most of the sequences that I got out of my own DNA sample would be human, right? This is not what we find for these ancient specimens. In 2006, working with Hendrik Poynar, who's at McMaster University, we sequenced a really well-preserved bone from a mammoth that we found in Siberia using this shotgun sequencing approach. About half of the DNA sequences that we got out of that bone mapped to the elephant genome. So about half of them looked like they were mammoth. The rest of them were things like fungi and plants and even human contamination. Most of it was unidentified environmental stuff. There's a lot of stuff that lives in the soil that we don't know the DNA sequence for. So when we sequence these bones, what we end up getting is a lot of microorganisms whose DNA sequences we don't know. So about half in this case of the DNA was mammoth. This, however, was an incredibly well-preserved bone. If we look at the same pie chart for some of the first Neanderthal bones that were used to sequence and assemble the Neanderthal genome, this is work done by Svante Paabo's research in Leipzig, the Max Planck Institute for Evolutionary Anthropology. Some of these early bones that they sequenced, they were finding that between 1 and 3% of the DNA they were getting out of these bones mapped to primates. So that includes any Neanderthal DNA that was in the bones and any human contamination that might have accidentally gotten into the experiment while it was being done. So most of the data that they were collecting was unidentified, environmental, probably microorganisms. Most of the data they're generating gets thrown away. So really what this would suggest is if we have a lot of money, like the Max Planck Institutes tend to have, we can just sequence really, really a lot of these bones and grind up the entire skeleton of these things, and eventually we'll come up with a complete genome, but it will happen. But that also is not necessarily true. So the other problem is that the DNA itself is in not very good condition. If you imagine that DNA sequences from a living organism, if I were to extract my own DNA, were very, very, very long strands, like streamers, which is why I have these pictures up here, very long, intact strands that you could sequence all these really nice long pieces for, the DNA sequences that we're getting out of these bones is a lot more like confetti, right? that's been run over by a herd of elephants in the rain at night. And we have to then pick up these pieces of DNA that are broken with double-strand breaks and nicks and the wrong chemicals attached to them and all tied together in knots of other co-extracted contaminants and somehow make sense of this and turn it into an actual living thing. This is not that easy, because if I were to pick up one of these broken pieces of DNA that's here, I would say, okay, so what is this? Is this one of the 3% of the thing that I'm actually interested in, or is this one of the 97% of stuff that I'm just going to throw away? And it's all broken and damaged and tiny. How am I going to figure it out? Well, for things like the mammoth and the Neanderthal, it's pretty easy because we have the elephant genome and the human genome, and we can pick up each of these pieces and say, okay, does this match the elephant genome? If it does, keep it. If it doesn't, throw it out, right? Does this match the human genome? If it does, keep it. If it doesn't, throw it out. But for many extinct species, there is not a closely related living organism that has an actual sequenced genome or a genome that can be sequenced. And for these, it's going to be much, much harder to actually piece together the genome from these tiny little broken, disgusting fragments. So we have some problems, just to summarize what these problems are. The DNA is damaged, it's broken. The samples are contaminated with stuff like environmental DNA, and we don't have a very good idea of what the genome should have looked like in the first place. So all seems pretty bad for actually sequencing long genomes, entire genomes of things, as a way to bring stuff back to life. But what if there were another way? What if instead of sequencing the entire genome from scratch, we could just pick and choose the pieces that were actually useful or informative or actually important to making that species look and act like it was? The genome itself is a really big place, right? And most of the genome is not genes. Genes actually only make up between 1% to 2% of what's there. The rest of it is other stuff that may or may not be doing anything important, but probably isn't something that we're really going to worry about if we're trying to piece together the genome of an extinct animal. So let's focus on these genes. If we can sequence and figure out the gene sequence of a genome, maybe that's the way to start bringing back an extinct animal. We can find them, and we can use tools that exist today for genome editing. Basically, these are enzymes that are designed specifically to target regions of the genome that we want to change, like a molecular scissors. You insert them into a cell, it finds the part of the genome we want to change, it cuts it, inserts the bit of DNA that we want to change, and you have changed the genome. You've edited the genome. This technology is being developed mostly with human health implications and agricultural implications in mind. If there's a genetic disease or genetic disorder that exists and we can go into a cell and actually change the DNA sequence to cure the disease, this is actual stuff that really does exist today. There are, in fact, three different types of molecular scissors that exist today. Zinc finger nucleases, talons, which is a very long thing. The acronym is for a very long word that I can't remember, so I'm not going to tell you what it is. And CRISPR-Cas, which is the more recently discovered version of this, which has very, very tight specificity. So it's really, really a scientifically awesome tool that is used to go in and find a specific part of the genome and edit that genome. Zinc fingers work a bit like this. Here's your DNA strand, and here's the way the enzyme works. You got this little cutting part right here, and this part is a specially designed linked series of probes that I recognize a specific DNA sequence. And there are actually companies out there that you can say, I want a probe that recognizes this sequence, this exact sequence. And they will make this probe for you. You deliver these into the cell. They find the part of the genome that you're trying to target. They cut the genome where they overlap. And then you can make a change. So here, let's say we've recognized a part of the genome that we know there's a specific difference between a mammoth and an elephant. We have the elephant genome here. All we have to do is insert the machinery to go and change it. And now we have the mammoth version of that gene. This is possible today. And there's no need for an intact cell. So this is something that is completely feasible given the data and the samples that we're collecting today. So what do we change? The technology is available. So how do we know what we're actually supposed to do? So here, I have a picture of a quite cute baby chimpanzee and my 18-month-old son, and they have 98% identical genomes, right? So there's a lot of similarity between this adorable creature and my child. Actually, that's him a little while ago. So how are we going to know which part of the genome we're going to target? So first of all, we would obviously look in the parts that are actually different from them. And with the human genome and the chimp genome, then that's pretty easy to do because we know that. We know what the genomes look like, and we can actually find those differences. Not true with these other things, but we do know some things. So for example, a few years ago, another research group, Mickey Hofreiter's group, also from the Max Planck Institute in Leipzig, discovered that there were some specific mutations that made the mammoth version of the melanocortin 1 receptor gene, which is involved in hair color, different from the elephant version. And so they went into some cells in culture and they made these differences in this plate. And then they measured how much of a particular type of enzyme these cells that were manipulated to have the mammoth version produced compared to the elephant version. And they found the elephant version produced more, the mammoth version produced some, and this is the control that didn't have the gene in it, produced none. And this was meant to show that mammoth version of this gene was actually responsible for making mammoths have red hair. Cool? Actually, we found that in a different part of this same, this wasn't me, this is Carlos Loaiza Fox's group, found that in a different part of this same gene, that Neanderthals also have one mutational difference, one amino acid change difference from humans, that has the same effect, a repression in the amount of this particular protein that's produced. So Neanderthals also have red hair. Turns out everything that used to be alive had red hair. Or maybe we're misinterpreting the data. Believe what you like, right? So now it's true, we can make elephants with red hair, right? So is that de-extinction? Does that count? Right? Probably not. More recently, a group identified three specific amino acid changes in part of the hemoglobin gene of mammoths that differentiated this part of the gene from the Asian elephant version of this. These blue things indicate the specific differences in the mammoth compared to the Asian elephant. And they found when measuring the capacity of this hemoglobin, and hemoglobin is a protein in the red blood cells that actually carries oxygen, that this version of hemoglobin is better able to transport oxygen around the body in cold climates. So now we're getting somewhere, right? Now we know how to make elephants that can survive in colder climates. For realsies, yeah? Yeah, we can totally do this. So is that a de-extinction, right? Just to think about here. So if we can identify all of the genetic differences that result in the phenotypic, how they look, and behavioral differences that distinguish an Asian elephant from a mammoth, we could go into a mammoth cell and actually edit the genome at every one of those places and turn that elephant genome into a mammoth genome using genome editing technologies. It's kind of harder when you start thinking about other species that are targets for de-extinction. This is the passenger pigeon here, and its closest living relative, the band-tailed pigeon. They look a lot alike. And there aren't genomes for any of these guys, and we don't know very much about their behavior. So when we start trying to ask, what do we change to make this guy look and act more like this guy, the question is actually harder to answer. But that would be plan C. Figure out what the important bits and find and replace them using genome editing. So how do we find them? Well, in 2001, this is the very first publication of the human genome. Here's some bad news, okay? I'm gonna put you up here, some bad news. 2001, first publication of the human genome. We have a lot of things that I'm not expecting you to be able to read that tell us what these genes, these parts of the genome do. And then there's this bit. See this really big bit right here? This huge bit right here? You know what that says? Molecular function unknown, human genome. Okay, oops. We're getting better. We know a little bit more about the molecular functions of the different parts of the human genome, but as we've learned what the genes and the regions that don't have genes in them and the retrotransposons and all the other stuff that makes up our genome do, what we've learned, in fact, is that there's this huge, intricate, linked network of things where genes are not acting in isolation. They're actually acting as part of this massive network. So one change in one gene might not have the same desired consequences if it's not also associated with a chain that happens in another gene. A really simple system to think about this is nuclear mitochondrial interactions. So the nuclear genome is what we've been talking about until now. The nucleus of the cell is where all of our chromosomes are, all the stuff that codes for what makes us look and act the way we do. But out here are mitochondria, and each of these things have their own genome. A long, long time ago, before the common ancestor of plants and animals, mitochondria were actually a free-living bacterial cell. They were absorbed by the common ancestor of us, and us and plants, and us and plants, and everything else that has mitochondria. And they provided an increased capacity to transmit oxygen. They made it easier for these cells to live, and so formed an excellent symbiosis. But these guys have their own genome. And when we're talking about replacing a genome or editing a genome or making new cells, we're talking about replacing that part of the genome and not this part of the genome, right? But there are many, many interactions between the genes in the mitochondria and the genes that are in the nuclear genome. And if we can't fix both of those at the same time, there might be disastrous consequences on one hand, or just no change at all on the other hand, both scenarios being equally bad for de-extinction. So genes don't act in isolation, and we need to be aware of that, another problem. And finally, the last problem to talk about is epigenetics. Who's heard the term epigenetics before? This is a kind of cool thing that blows the minds of people who understand evolution by natural selection and believe that everything is in the genome. It turns out that not everything is in the genome. That there are some things, mostly things that regulate the expression of genes, that are inherited, but not in the genome and not in the way that we would expect. So there's been research that shows that rats, these are very cute rats, right? Rats that are nurtured in life will express different genes in different amounts, and they will also have offspring that they nurture. Rats that are not nurtured early in life will express different amounts of those genes and will not be good nurturing parents. This is not because their genes are different. It's because the amount of genes and the timing of expression of those genes differs between them, and that's determined by something that's not part of their genome, but by the methylation patterns that say when and where genes are actually expressed. And these patterns are things that are established outside of the normal modes of inheritance. In fact, there have been studies that have shown that what your mother ate before she got pregnant with you and then stopped eating while she was pregnant with you will still affect your gene expression patterns after you're born. There are weird heritability things going on that we don't understand, but this means that if we don't know what the diet of a mommy mammoth was, it was probably certainly not the same thing as the diet of a mommy elephant. And if we can't recapitulate the mammoth diet, we're going to change the expression patterns of the different genes, so even if we get the genome sequence right, we won't get the gene expression right, and we're probably going to end up with an elephant anyway. So, the DNA is damaged, the samples are contaminated, the species is extinct, the genomes are complicated places, and epigenetics happens. So is all of this surmountable? I'm not going to answer that. I don't know. Possibly. So where are we today? What is going on in the field of de-extinction these days? There's a large group of individuals who are involved with what's called a de-extinction listserv, and we have chats to each other every now and then about the projects that are going on. This is just to introduce you to some of the people that were involved in the recent TEDx that was held at National Geographic, organized by Stuart Brand and Ryan Phelan of the Long Now Foundation. And these guys got together and we talked about some of the ethical problems and implications of de-extinction, also some of the projects that are ongoing. In Europe, there's a very large group of individuals who are trying to push something called rewilding. And this is a type of de-extinction. I'll leave it up to you to say whether or not it really is de-extinction. But they're trying to bring extinct species back without having anything to do with the genetic manipulation or DNA sequencing. Instead, what they're doing is they're identifying individuals that have the characteristics of the extinct species and breeding them together, similar to what our species has been doing for at least the last 30,000 years in trying to domesticate things like dogs and horses and all the things that we eat, except going in the reverse direction. They're trying to come up with the pre-domesticated, the ancestral species. They're focusing right now on the auroch. This is a big, mean, giant cow that's the ancestor of all the different types of living cattle. Interestingly, this present-day rewilding operation is not the first time anyone has tried to bring back the cows. In the 1930s, there was actually a group of Germans who were trying to re-engineer aurochs through rewilding, and they've actually come up with this cattle that's called the Heck cattle. It actually looks almost nothing like an auroch, but they didn't really know what an auroch looked like anyway, so, you know, they made a bigger cow with curved horns and said, new auroch. So what's going on with cloning? So there are some examples where people have used somatic cell nuclear transfer in attempt to de-extinct things. These are special examples where the animal that they were using was not dead when they took the cells. So it wasn't like a mammoth where you have to find a frozen remain that's still in pretty good shape. Instead, they were taking cells from something that was still alive. So a bucardo is a little animal that used to live in Spain. And this is Celia. She's the last bucardo. And before Celia died, they captured her, and they took living cells, living tissues from one of her ears. And then she died. She was actually crushed by a falling tree after having lived for more than a year as the only remaining individual in her species. They attempted to do somatic cell nuclear transfer by getting some goats, mountain goats, and trying to make Celia's cells into pluripotent stem cells and introduced the embryos into a goat. The goats did not like this, as you can see by this picture that Alberto put up during his TEDx talk. In fact, it didn't work at all. In fact, they eventually did make a hybrid ibex goat, and they were able to, after many, many failed attempts, bring one bucardo to term. It was born, so is this a successful de-extinction? It survived for 8 minutes before it died. It had an extra lobe in its lung, and it actually suffocated in those 8 minutes, and it hasn't been tried since then. There's a team in Australia that's working to bring back to life an animal called the Lazarus frog, also the gastric brooding frog. Weird animal, as many things in Australia are. This thing, after it has the eggs, it swallows them. The things develop in the stomach for a little while, and then it throws up the babies, right? The gastric brooding frog. But it's extinct. It's been extinct for a little while. They have frozen individuals from freezers that they were using to create cells, and they actually have been able to make cells. But that's as far as that particular project has gotten. So should we? And this is the last part of the talk, and here we turn from what I know about the science that's going on to really what my opinion is. And I kind of just put together a series of questions that I hope will spur a bit of debate, and I'll go through them a little bit at a time, so bear with me as I do this. I tend to get a little bit upset about it. So, who gets to decide? If we are going to bring something back to life, do we take a vote? Is this something that, I mean, who is the person who gets to decide that we want to bring back the mammoth compared to the gastric brooding frog or the bucardo or some crazy thing like a saber-toothed cat? Is this something that should be decided by the public or by politicians or by scientists? How is this going to happen? Probably it's going to happen by whatever lab does the work gets to decide, but that doesn't really seem fair, especially since we're starting at a point before it happens. So shouldn't we have the capacity to contribute to this discussion? If we bring it back, is it what it was or is it something new? And this will depend on how much of what you think we have to change in order to have it qualify as a de-extinction. So if we change an elephant so that it contains 0.0001% mammoth DNA and it's born, are we going to say we've brought a mammoth back to life? I bet a scientist wouldn't say that, but I bet the media does. As soon as they catch any wind that a very, very small amount, even one gene of a mammoth, has been brought back inside a living elephant, the headline will say, we have de-extincted a mammoth, or George Church has brought a mammoth back to life. But will that be true? If we do bring something back, what category does it fall into? Is it an endangered species? And if it is, does that mean that wherever we put it, we really have to know what the consequences of putting an endangered species in that particular area is? After all, if something is an endangered species, it comes with a whole suite of legal restrictions about what can and cannot be done in that particular area. We can't hunt there anymore. We can't hike there anymore. We can't camp there anymore because there's an endangered species maybe that's going to be out there. If it's not an endangered species, then perhaps it's a GMO. And then we have a whole nother suite of legal, of legislative conundrums that we're going to have to deal with to try to figure out what it is. In particular, a kind of weird one, can we patent it? So can I say, oh, look, my mammoth? And if we can, is that going to be a good way to actually get funding for this research? Because public institutions aren't going to fund this crazy stuff. But if I were to go to Google and say, what about Brin's sea cow? You know, is that a good way to actually get funding for this thing? Can I patent these animals? And if it is a GMO, then there is legislation that says that it's not allowed to cross international borders. How are we going to tell that to a passenger pigeon, right? Oh, I'm sorry. No, you got to go through customs declaration right there. No, you're going to have to wait 6 months in line here before you can get through. We really have to understand, if we're going to bring something back, how it's going to affect the community that's already there. This is critically important, in particular when we're bringing back things or thinking about bringing back things that have been extinct for a long time. The passenger pigeon has been extinct for 100 years. In that time, the niche that it once occupied has been filled with other things. If we bring that passenger pigeon back, how is it going to affect the species that are already there? We really need to carefully think about this for each species that we're talking about. What effect does de-extinction, both the idea of actually doing it and putting these things back out in the wild, have on conservation efforts? Are we competing with conservationists for resources, limited resources to do this work? At this stage, absolutely not. The funding for the technical developments going into de-extinction are going into the genome editing stuff, for example, human medical research or agricultural research. But if we come to the point where we're starting to introduce this thing into the wild, absolutely it will be competing with conservation efforts for limited resources. Is it, in that case, just too expensive? And who should actually be the person to fund this kind of stuff? I mean, there's a limited budget for pretty much everything that's going on. Is this just too crazy an idea, too silly an idea to actually face, to try to use this resources up with? Can we identify appropriate surrogates? So, for many of these species, stellar sea cow is an obvious example, but even the mammoth and the elephant is an example. I mean, is it really fair to put a species inside another species and ask that species to give its body for this particular cause? Is it worth it? Is it that important? For Dolly, there were more than 100 animals, 100 tries at making Dolly before it worked. For all of the successful cloning efforts that we've seen, whether it's been cats or dogs or horses or cows, there are many, many, many rounds and iterations of this process that we go through before you end up getting one successful birth, and those births are not always healthy births. Does it cause too much animal suffering? Is this something that we just shouldn't consider doing? And in fact, should we not be spending our attention and focusing our attention and our resources and our money and our time and our energy on species that are not yet extinct? And to end on that, I would like to say that we are, with the Long Now Foundation, working on projects to use this genome editing technology on populations and species that are endangered and that have very little genetic diversity. And we're using this technology to go back in time and look at diversity that once existed and then re-engineer more diversity into these populations. So this is the more serious science end of using this technology, the same technology for de-extinction, but on living populations, populations that are alive today. So that is where I will open it up to questions to you by asking, what do you think? Should we?
All right, the floor is open, and you can tweet stuff because she'll pick it up too. Floor is open for questions. Who's going to start?
Nobody cares.
Sir.
My first comment is I think that the verb.
I think the verb is to extinguish. Extinction is the act of extinguishment, so that when you make something extinct, you extinguish it.
So it should be de-extinction.
No, de-extinction is good. That's a noun.
Oh, okay. But as a verb,
but you when you to get to de-extinction, you unextinguish things.
Do you know who used who first used the term de-extinction?
I don't know. And in fact, this is a huge contentious issue among people who are doing this, because to de-extinct something is stupid, right? It just sounds ridiculous, right? So I think what we all like is resurrect, except there are religious connotations with resurrect that nobody really likes. But it does make the most sense, and realistically, logically, to resurrect something is really what we're talking about.
Scientific resurrection is a lot more feasible than religious resurrection.
Or about the same amount of feasible at this point.
We're not sure.
Well, that's right. I think, you know, your answer, I mean, the answer in the end there is can we? Well, we can't. Whatever we recreate will be some facsimile of whatever was, but that doesn't mean you can't still work, as you do in living animals, on increasing the genetic diversity, find more and more diversity in more and more ancient samples and do that kind of thing. But I think just in general of your depressing set of questions at the end, I think you should lighten up. You know, the fact that our ancestors wiped out the passenger pigeon is sad, but it's provided a really interesting problem for people nowadays to tackle. And I think that's one of our duties as humans in this universe is to find interesting problems. And so in some ways, it's part of our duty to create interesting problems for the next generation. And I think that's what a lot of this stuff is. You know, that you go so far and then you figure out how you can back off and how you can fix things. And, you know, the Thames River was wiped out of salmon. An interesting problem that my colleagues had of this generation was how can we clean up that river so salmon would return to the river, and that's been done. And so, you know, lighten up.
Can I speak to that actually?
Please.
Before we move on? I thank you for that. I appreciate that. What I would like to say is, I feel strongly that we can't resurrect an extinct species, but I also don't think it's important that we can't resurrect an extinct species if our job is to is more ecological resurrection than species resurrection. So if for example there's a habitat like the tundra in Siberia that could use something like a large herbivore like a mammoth to come in and actually stomp on the ground and deposit nitrogen and cause all this stuff to start growing again, and thereby providing more habitat for species like the saiga antelope, which need places to live right now, then we don't have to have a mammoth to do that. Making an elephant that has some of the traits of the mammoth that enable it to survive in that habitat is good enough for me. And I think that is where this whole thing is going, and not at this purest version of resurrection or de-extinction or de-re-extinguishment. But thank you for that.
Yes.
Why should we bring back extinct animals? Like, will there be a purpose for them? Like, the saber-toothed tiger, are we just adding another threat or something?
Yeah, that's I think one of the most important questions. Why should we? Well, you said, why might we bring back? What actually motivates these people to even talk about this? You say there are meetings, there's a listserv. What is the real motivation?
Well, similar to my answer to the previous question, I think the motivation is ecological restoration. So if there are examples where there is an ecosystem that is destabilized because of a recent extinction of something, and by filling that niche that has been vacated, we can restabilize that ecosystem and save all the other stuff that would have otherwise gone extinct without it, then I think there's an important role to play for this type of work. I am a fan of the idea of moving things from one environment to another, and some of my colleagues would cut off my head for saying that. If they are going to play an important stabilizing role to the community there, and also to increase the biodiversity that's available. We care a lot about biodiversity. And to address your comment about introducing something that's scary and dangerous, I think we spend a lot of energy worrying about what's going to be dangerous and scary. We don't really know the answer to that, right? I mean, the Tasmanian tiger was driven to extinction because they thought it was killing babies, and sheep, and it wasn't. It was a perceived threat, perceived danger. Perhaps if we'd understood it better, that species would not be extinct.
There's a comment up here.
It seems to me that you talk that you said a lot about there's so much that's unknown. It's going to take a lot to be unknown, or to be figured out. But, you know, is this going to happen? Is this going to happen or not going to happen? To me, it seems obvious that it is. You seem to be wanting to and indicating that other people are chomping at the bit to start doing things, like adding diversity to species. Yet you don't really know what the end effect might be. Isn't that, in your mind, absolutely playing absolute Russian roulette? And do you think people in this field, their ego, you know, it's one of those things, if you build a nuclear bomb, you want to blow one off. You're not just going to say, well, is this going to work theoretically? So, I mean, people in this field have to want to do the change, right? What do you do? You suggested, well, maybe we need an animal up in the tundra to, you know, for whatever purpose. I mean, that all of a sudden becomes world engineering. And do you think there, you know, one, egos will get totally out of control here, that there could be a huge, something that's reincarnated that could wipe out the population? And thirdly, would you suspect that there are people right now trying to do Dr. Moreau type experiments and who knows what the hell mutant blobs are out there?
So the question is, so this kind of, part of it is motivation and whether what you just said is really the real motivation or is there something else going on? Because it sounds like there's lots, you know, like people are working really hard and maybe there's some ulterior motives there. And what are the chances of getting it wrong?
So the motivation is obviously going to vary from person to person. I mean, I think that some people are working on it because it's cool. You know, you can engineer an extinct species back to life, and who wouldn't want to do that? I don't think that we will be able to engineer an extinct species back to life, and I think that part of what we're going to face as a consequence of all this is a decision that we're each going to have to make in our own mind about whether to believe the headline when the headline that says a mammoth has been brought back to life, whether that's true. So we need to know what we believe needs to constitute a mammoth in order to believe that a mammoth has been brought back to life, whether that's good enough to be one gene or two genes or many genes, or it has to be a complete, identical, 100% mammoth. We have to think hard about each species that we consider for this project. I mean, is there a possibility for disaster? Sure, just like there's a possibility for disaster when we cut down a whole bunch of forests and drive a bunch of things to extinction and potentially release different pathogens and viruses out into the atmosphere. There's a possibility for disaster in every step that everybody takes every day. But we can't stop this science from going on. And I think one thing that's nice about this debate that's going on right now, because it's being driven by the media and not really by science, is that we can have the discussion and the public debate and think about the potential disastrous consequences of these things before it actually happens. And I think that is rare in science.
Do you think this de-extinction is qualitatively different from some of the other sort of scientific technological advances that people are initially scared of? Is there something, more fundamental about, because it's de-extinction and it's playing God and all these things, that it has a different flavor? Or do you think it is just like any other technology that at first people think is kind of scary and then they get used to?
You know, I think it's similar to other technology, and I disagree that it's playing God. I mean, it's a...
people hear it and they think it's playing God.
It's only playing God in as much as our species has been manipulating other species to be and look and act and taste the way that we want them to taste since we have been able to do that. I mean, this is scientific advance happens because we have big brains, and, you know, this is the way progress happens.
There's a yes,
terrible,
sir.
Controversial statement.
First of all, thanks very much for a very entertaining talk and educational. But I also have to say I'm a geologist. So first of all, hopefully you don't have the same opinion of a geologist as Sheldon Cooper from the Big Bang Theory with this question. But whenever I watch a Hollywood movie that relates with a geology theme, Dante's Peak and The Core, I have a really hard time sitting through it. So the obvious question is Jurassic Park and all of its sequels. If it's so difficult to, say, clone a relatively recent animal, then what are your feelings about actually the reality of cloning an organism from that far back, a dinosaur?
Right. So that question probably comes up. So how much information can we get as we go back in time, and when is there simply not enough information to do any of this?
The oldest bone that has had DNA sequenced from it is 700,000 years old. It's a horse bone that is from the Yukon, from one of these sites, that like the picture that was here. And we collected a few years ago and extracted DNA, and we're able to piece together a horse genome. And it's just a horse, domestic horse, just like regular horse, but 700,000 years old, so lacking a little bit of evolution. Mostly, though, the reach of ancient DNA is somewhere in the range of 100,000 years, and that's in the very best conditions for survival, so where stuff has been cold and frozen and stable, and there's not a lot of sunlight getting onto it, and these are the very best conditions. There's some thought that maybe if we were able to find things that were frozen for longer than 700,000 years, there might be a small chance that there's DNA surviving in them, but we don't know of any permafrost that's older than 700,000 years. The oldest permafrost is this particular bit. It was published by Dwayne Fraser's group. He's a geologist at University of Alberta. So that's the oldest frozen specimen we know of. Dinosaurs are well out. Yeah, there's no chance. Unless we want to make up entirely what a dinosaur genome would look like. And we could do that by estimating what the genome sequence of the common ancestor of birds looked like, right? Because birds are dinosaurs, right? They are. But you want to see non-avian dinosaurs. Birds are living dinosaurs. Yeah, those of you who want to be walking around with dinosaurs, this is the time of your life. Yeah, there are birds outside. But if we could just make up what that sequence looked like, we might be able to eventually piece together a genome to code for some dinosaur stuff, but not going to happen.
And what would be the critter that you would put into it?
A dinosaur?
And what organism is going to carry a dinosaur embryo?
It's not a mammal.
Right. It would
you just need an artificial egg, right?
You need an artificial egg. At the back there, yeah. And then here.
Yeah, go ahead.
I should say, though, before we move on, that Jurassic Park, when Michael Crichton wrote the book, the introduction to that book actually acknowledges Svante Paabo and Alan Wilson at the lab at Berkeley, who were the very first people to be working on ancient DNA, as giving him the inspiration for the idea behind Jurassic Park. So it's often said that Jurassic Park motivated the scientific field that I work in, which is not true. It was the other way around. Thank goodness.
If you were able to recreate or create something, do you think you would be able to manage a self-sustaining population, or would this be something that would always require human involvement?
Right, so that's a very good question, because Beth's been talking about how you could engineer something that you could then put back in the ecosystem. Most people who think of de-extinction think of one woolly mammoth that comes out, or one dolly. So can you scale this up? How would you scale this up to get a big enough population?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, and I didn't touch on that part of the process of de-extinction, because I was focusing mostly on the technical hurdles to get to actually having an animal. We know from captive breeding experiments that some species are good at captive breeding and are capable of then surviving as independent populations in the wild, and other species are not. And we don't know enough yet about what characteristics make a species either capable of sustaining themselves in the wild or not. But because my interest in de-extinction or in this field is in ecological resurrection, or in putting species that have a particular habitat into an environment and having them survive as a natural population, that's a really important question to me. I think that we don't know. Some of these different species that we're talking about, I mean, there's an enormous group of people who really want to bring the passenger pigeon back to life, which I don't get. But they're talking about breeding passenger pigeons in small groups in the Bronx Zoo or in the Cincinnati Zoo, where the very last passenger pigeon lived, and somehow then having this captive breeding program and then monitoring in the wild. We know from some of the captive breeding programs that have been semi-successful, like the California Condor program, that this part is extremely expensive and time-consuming. And even if we were to get through all of these technical hurdles to come up with an extinct animal, we're not even half the way there to having a surviving, flourishing, wild population. And all of that research will have to be done at that time.
Sir.
Assuming that our motivations are pure, and we've determined the why for ecological restoration, wouldn't you say that there might be a case to be made for recreating the desirable environmental conditions and maintaining them to allow that those creatures to, instead of to re-evolve, in a sense, like the case for re-evolution rather than de-extinction.
So can we take a longer view? So this is, again, if you can create elephants that could live in the north, and we were able to have a north, then the long-term view is that then they would simply become a part of the tapestry of life and evolve as everything else would.
Sure, so two parts to that question. First, I think it's important that when we are talking about not the why, but the who, or which species to bring back, one of the things that we must know is why that species went extinct in the first place. If we don't know why the species went extinct in the first place, then we can't solve whatever problem it was that caused that species to go extinct. In many cases, it's going to be that the habitat that they require to survive no longer exists. So if we were to bring that species back, it would simply go extinct again, right? Because it didn't have anywhere to live. So absolutely, we need to consider what habitat is available and how a species would survive and maintain that particular habitat. As for taking the longer view, I think this is precisely the idea behind the rewilding movement, where they're attempting to breed individuals with traits that they perceive as representing the thing that they want to bring back, in hopes that evolution will actually take care of the reemergence of these traits in a particular species. The idea behind doing the genome editing or genome engineering is just to speed that up a bit. An elephant takes somewhere between 7 and 11 years to become fertile and 2 years to have an offspring. If we wait for evolution to bring us back a mammoth, we're going to be waiting for a long time. Actually, that's wrong. It's like 14 years, and then 2 years to gestate.
All the way across.
A bit of a fun question. With all the techniques that you're developing for gene manipulation and so on, do you see that technology being adapted in other areas for different purposes? I mean, going to the extreme of, say, human augmentation, or even as silly as glow-in-the-dark kittens, and, you know, and being used for commercial purposes.
Yeah, so can you tell us a little bit about what the CRISPR technology is being used for? You did say something about it, you can fix diseases, but what do other people say might be the future of these?
Yeah, so there are already glow-in-the-dark chicks. That's not because of genome editing, that's because somebody's put green fluorescent protein in the genomes that have been inserted. This is part of the technology that's being developed to try to do nuclear transfer in birds. So birds have a very complicated process by which the germ cells actually migrate, primordial germ cells migrate around the body. So you actually have to have two generations before you see the results of your genome, of your nuclear transfer. And so one of the ways that people have tried to see whether it works or not is insert these green fluorescent protein genes into the chicks. And so chicks are born that glow in the dark, which is kind of crazy. You can find them on Google image search and contact the people who've made them. CRISPR technology is being used, one of the applications from George Church's lab is actually to try to make an edit to part of the CCR5 receptor, which is a protein that is found in most T cells that HIV uses to gain entry into those T cells. There are certain versions of that gene that the virus can't use to get into a cell. And that lab is using the CRISPR technology to change the cell from whatever the individual was born with to this HIV resistant type to make people not susceptible to AIDS. That is a patent that is ongoing with trials at the moment. So this is like real science that's happening with these genes. It's also been used to fix different respiratory diseases. I'm not sure about the details of them. I don't know that there are any actually in humans trials yet. I think most of the stuff is going on in cell culture at the trial stage, but CRISPR technology is really young, like 6 months kind of young, but really catching on. Other applications that genome editing has been used for is to introduce herbicide resistance genes into different crop species so that they will continue to grow even when we spray them with herbicides. So this genome editing technology has real life application, and that is actually where the development is coming in, not for de-extinction or ecological resurrection or improving genetic diversity in populations. These approaches are the tangential side things that are tagging along as it's being developed for human health and economic implications, as I fall over by pushing this thing.
Next question, comment, sir.
Let's suppose you could re-engineer. Let's suppose you could re-engineer a mammoth. You're going to have it just stated in the body of a regular elephant. So it's going to look like a mammoth, but it's going to be an elephant.
Might not even look like a mammoth. Might look like an elephant.
Yeah. So the research hasn't been done, I guess.
No. So that's exactly the question. So we don't act. Do we know anything about how much control the mom has on what it looks like? So what, like with Dolly and all this other cloning stuff?
Well, I mean, there are certain phenotypic traits that are coded purely by the different genes, and there are other phenotypic traits that depend on the timing of gene expression, and it certainly is possible that gene expression is regulated during neonatal development or antenatal development by the mother. And in that case, if you're working with two species that have very, very similar genomes, and the differences are just in the timing and amount of gene expression, if the mom is an elephant and the gene expression will be driven by an elephant, then that gene, whatever that gene is supposed to be doing, will look like an elephant. So maybe in that case, we actually need two rounds.
Okay, thank you.
Or more.
Rolf, you can just talk.
You haven't said anything about plants, and I'm just wondering, because plants can be cloned asexually, is it possible to resurrect an extinct plant as opposed to an animal?
Yeah, so might plants be easier to de-extinct than animals?
Nobody cares about plants.
Okay, I think we're done.
I'm just kidding.
Seriously, what's being done with plants? Do you know?
There's actually not, there is some work being done with plants. There's a group led by Bill Powell from New York who is trying to bring back the American chestnut. Sorry, my alarm's going off. And they're using kind of genome engineering to try to make a chestnut blight resistant plant that will actually grow, and having some really good success. I mean, they're starting with something that's alive, of course, that dies only after it reaches a certain height when the blight can actually kill it. So they have living cells to start with. Plants are weird. You know, there was a story that one of the Russian scientists, do you remember who it was, published a few years ago, where they actually managed to get some seeds to germinate that were from Pleistocene age permafrost?
Lupins,
yeah. But it's hard to know whether those lupins were modern or ancient. You know, it's an interesting open question. I taught a class, a graduate seminar about de-extinction last spring at Santa Cruz, and I asked the students as the first exercise in the class to pick a species to bring back and to defend that species. And one person did choose a plant, but it turns out that no one is really sure that that plant actually ever existed. So it was quite hard to figure out whether
the one from Carthage.
Yeah.
Is it the plant from Carthage?
No, it's one that grows under the ground. It's a little tiny white plant from just outside of Chicago. And its most close living relative that is, in fact, almost identical to it is from Australia. And this particular plant is only known in three herbarium collections collected from the same location in the early 1900s. So, meh. Mm. She didn't win.
Oh, sorry. Hi.
Yes, I wonder if you could elaborate on your final comment about using modification to increase biodiversity in endangered species.
Right.
And if you can explain where you would get the genes that you would be using to increase the biodiversity, and how would you know which ones would be good ones to add to the animals?
Right. So how do you use the technology you've been talking about to increase the genetic variation in endangered species? You had those slides up of the...
Yeah. So one of the species that we've been thinking about is the black-footed ferret. Black-footed ferret has been through a very recent population bottleneck and has lost most of its genetic diversity. There are samples of black-footed ferrets that were taken 20, 30-ish years ago. It was prior to the very tight population bottleneck where they almost went extinct, that are kept frozen as part of the frozen zoo in San Diego that Ollie Ryder is in charge of. And so our idea there is to sequence those genomes, which are genetically very different from the individuals that are alive today, and to use that as a basis on which to try to engineer some of that lost diversity into the population. Your second question, which is how do we know which parts are useful, is an excellent one. And I don't know the answer to that, and I don't think anyone does. And this is a question that comes up a lot. You know, just because there is a difference in one genome versus another doesn't mean that that difference actually manifests in any way, or that that difference is going to provide something, a bit of extra oomph, as it were, or survivability. But the bigger question is, if we don't try this, this is a technique that we could try, and if we don't try it, then is it worse? You know, are we really, we don't know if it works, but it's a potential solution to a problem that's gonna cause the extinction of these species. And we won't know whether it helps until we do it, and we can. So should we? It's hard.
So is that active research with the black-footed ferret?
Yes.
Are there any other species with which this is being attempted?
We're very interested also in working with the black rhino, but this is a politically much more difficult thing to do.
Okay.
Rolf asked about plants, so I think it's fair that I ask about marine invertebrates. So
no one cares about those either.
That's what I was wondering. Well, there's a pretty active shellfish industry on the West Coast, and there's problems with ocean acidification, and certainly are there some genetic strains that are going to be better adapted, and so. Has anyone looked at implementing any of your research in marine invertebrates?
So again, can you use these I guess you're talking mostly about the techniques for genome editing. Has anyone used it for marine invertebrates with reference to ocean acidification?
Or does anyone care?
I would say yes. Yes, people do care. And people care about a lot of different species, but there's very little known about the amount of genetic diversity in any of these populations. Remember, all of this technology is very new. CRISPR technology has been successfully used thus far on 20 species. 20, that's it. And that's a huge number of species compared to zinc fingers or talons, which were used mostly just with humans and some plant species initially. So this is a field that is really in the beginning stages, the early stages of its usefulness. Development, but all signs are pointing to it being useful in a variety of different species across taxonomic levels. And so, yes, it is potentially a way that one might be able to reintroduce diversity or to identify things or to do genome editing in lots of different species. More critically, though, is if there are environmental changes that are ongoing right now that are putting all of these different things in danger, what we should be doing is biobanking these samples. Take the samples that exist today before they've gone through this population bottleneck or near extinction event and put them in a frozen zoo where, once this technology is available, we can go back to these samples and the diversity that's alive today and use that for the betterment of the species in future.
Yes. There was a, yes, question or comment there, yeah.
Hi there. I'm interested in and appreciate the fact that you're having intercollegial conversations, inter-institutional conversations about the ethics and introducing biodiversity. For the most part, it seems very ethical how you're trying to approach things. What about the tangential experiences that are happening? Is there an ethical body? Because that seems to me that where the public gets this dystopian view of what's going to happen.
So you're saying, are there already bodies set up to do this, do the hard discussing about these things?
Not so much about the research that's happening
No.
in institutions, but all these tangential things that are happening as a result. some of it medicine, but some of it's certainly going into farming and food cultures and even possibly commercial and industrial usages. So what's happening with that second step of where this information in this purest way that's being discovered, what's happening when it becomes the property of a company, for example?
So this probably, if I understand you correctly, is a sort of a GMO kind of question, is that how does this stuff that you're talking about fit into this larger discussion about who controls and who discusses GMOs, which these are effectively, you're talking about GMOs here.
Specifically the ethics.
Like, yeah, well, this is the...
There's a strong ethical core within the academic and the research area, but this secondary, the benefits, let's call them, right. Are there ethical discussions on who gets that information?
So in our group, we have, and this is a small and early stages of things, we have tried to include social scientists and ethicists and conservation biologists in all stages of the discussion, certainly in our listserv where we have these discussions. The lab stuff that goes on, like in George Church's lab or in my lab or whatever, we're not controlled by an ethical body. If we're not doing research on living animals, we're not even controlled by, you know, the bodies that exist that make you go out and make sure that you're not hurting things by doing scientific research, because I'm chopping up a bone of something that's been dead for 20,000 years. I'm not actually causing that animal any pain, so there's no way to regulate that. As far as the kind of legal ethical implications of GMOs, there's, as you know, a huge, you know, global community that's interested in trying to understand what's going on. Whether or not these are actually GMOs, though, hasn't really been agreed upon. I think that we've engaged some people that are involved with the U.S. government side with implementation of the Endangered Species Act, and they will say, it's not ours. You know, we don't want to have to deal with that stuff and come up with all sorts of reasons as to why, but I think this is a discussion that still has to happen. We don't know where these things are going to fit when they come in, and probably it will be something about GMOs, but it's going to be hard to regulate and hard to know. I think it's crucially important to involve people in these discussions who are social scientists and ethicists and even legal experts. We have Hank Greeley, who's a legal expert in the ethics of biotechnology from Stanford, has been integrally involved with this discussion since the beginning and has a couple of papers with some of his students and fellows discussing the topic. But it's a big one, and you're right to be concerned.
And it's very early days, I think, is the best thing. Was there another all the way around? As Laurie's going to the back, I went to a meeting last fall where it was philosophers and biologists, and one of the talks was by a philosopher about the philosophy of de-extinction. And the senior conservation biologist in the audience stood up and said, de-extinction is venal. And I had to look the word up. He was one of the strongest words I've ever
was
heard.
Was it Paul Ehrlich?
I'll tell you later. conservation biologist, and he was representing a stream of conservation biologists that believe that de-extinction is evil, actually. And I mean, you that was one of your questions, right? Is one of those questions, is should we do it? But it is very a touchy topic between the technology people and the conservation biologists for some of the reasons that Beth pointed out. So, yeah, sir.
I like what you said about if... We just because we can, should we? And that whole discussion. And what I often think about is, like, especially with Dolly, one part of the world is going ahead because the government okays it, and another part of the world is restricting it, like stem cell research. And there's no coordination on a global level, but we live in a limited biosphere that everything has an effect, yet someone across the world could be going ahead. And so we're sort of not having the discussion first. We're sort of saying we're going to have the discussion later. And I see that in many things in terms of the environment, and I think that's pretty sad. But my real question is about the disease aspect. And I think I read just recently that in the permafrost, they discovered a deadly bacteria disease from you know, a billion years ago or something like that, right? I don't know if there's any truth to that.
So there was a, right. So there was a
disease, right?
Do you know about the story in the media about they finding a virus?
Yeah, a megavirus
exactly.
Of an amoeba.
Could you tell us a bit? And they said perhaps there'll be all these other things that were going to come seeping out of the permafrost imminently. Do you know anything about that?
I don't know very much about that. I am surprised that a virus would survive in the permafrost. It's they don't survive very well, like on sinks or on door handles. And to survive for thousands of years in the permafrost seems very unlikely to me.
Any other questions or comments? If not, I suggest we thank Beth Shapiro once again for a very interesting evening.